This video is about the Gothic classic continuity. The nature of magic in Gothic is rather well explained. It just requires a lot of time to properly wrap your head around the concept, as the information is gathered piece by piece throughout the entirety of three whole games. Well, more like 2.5 games, but whatever. As we already established, magic originates from the gods, as magic is nothing more than the divine power of creation. A magician does not cast spells from his own power. Rather, a magician is nothing more than a conduit. With training, one can use his inherent magic power to extend the spirit beyond the mortal sphere. In this one moment of total concentration, a mage can tap into the realm of gods, from where the actual power comes from. With the spirit as a conduit, the mage can shape the power to influence theoretically anything. Theoretically. Magic can be found all over the world, as the world and its elements originate from the same power of creation. According to a myth, one could even reach a state known as true power. This state is the highest attainable goal for any magician, as this magus would be a being with true, absolute power, living above any other mortal man or any other being in the mortal plane of existence. The laws of nature are inferior to the laws of magic, and even death itself was a creation of the divine. So if there was a mage who not only guides and influences but has control of magic, then this individual would live beyond any physical or natural laws. Think about it. If you were capable of having full control of magic in Gothic, you would live beyond death, beyond time, and even beyond space. Literally, no natural law or rule would apply to you, as you already are in control of that aspect in reality. In other words, if you were an individual of true power, only the gods would be capable of stopping you. However, there's no record of anyone ever reaching this state. Now let's talk about astronomy. Astronomy can strongly influence the world, but not just in terms of making calendars. The universe of Gothic works like this. In the center is Adenor's realm, also known as Morgrad, in which the events of Gothic take place. At the core, deep below the earth, it is said that one can find gateways to Belial's realm. One could easily describe the god of darkness's domain as the realm of the dead, if said realm of the dead was filled with tons of demons, monsters, and other supernatural beings. It is literally the opposite for Enos, whose realm is said to be at the sun, with gateways existing in the sky. To round up the topic of astronomy, every millennium, the stars of the warriors and those of the orcs align. When this happens, the boundaries between the three spheres weaken tremendously, to the point where summoning archdemons, and worse, becomes significantly easier. Sometimes there's not even a need for summoning rituals, as demons can just cross over to Morgrad by their own will. That is the power of astronomy in Gothic. Okay, now we finally got the basics out of the way. The only remaining question is, what can you do with this information, and what does magic actually look like? As in pretty much every other fantasy universe, there are spell scrolls that can be used one time, as long as said person fulfills the most basic requirements of using them. So, across the board, this is the kind of magic that is most useful for the average person. Things do start to get more interesting from here. First off, there's rune magic, the main method for performing magic in Gothic. The concept for casting magic, as previously described, applies to rune magic as well. The difference is the lack of multitasking, as the runestone takes over the job of channeling the magic power into a specific spell. Casting this kind of magic requires a lot of training, and the power of the individual spells is divided into 6 circles. The higher the circle, the more powerful spells the mage can cast.
Each ruin contains the structure of a special magic spell. By using your own magic powers, you'll be able to cast the magic of the ruin. Your own magic power is used up when you use a ruin, but you need to learn much if you want to recognize the true secrets of magic. You know that you can use every ruin as often as you like, until you've used up all of your own powers. This knowledge is the foundation for your further path. Understand the magic, then you'll discover the secret of power.
However, this knowledge is kept from the peasants, and is exclusive to those who join the Circle of Fire, the Circle of Water, or those who follow Beliar. Additionally, only the mages have access to empty rune stones, which are made of magic ore. The reason why eventually everybody started using rune stones is actually very simple: the average rate of success. You see, before rune stones were created, barely anyone was capable of using magic. It required too much, and even after completing the training, only the fewest had the skill to conjure spells. Runestones took care of that problem. Even the Order of Enos, of which originally only 12 paladins were able to use magic, ended up converting to rune magic for the same reason. This means that those without any magic aptitude can't use magic whatsoever. But even for those without training, there are certain spells that only require enough magic capacities in the user, like the teleportation runes. Speaking of which, teleportation comes in form of three ways: spell scrolls, runes, and stones. Teleportation spell scrolls are one-time use for a single target, nothing more. The runes can be used repeatedly, but you can only use one spell per rune, and it requires enough magic power to use them in the first place. Teleportation stones, on the other hand, are weird. They are based on ancient magic, and for some reason, they don't require magic power to use. Finally, there are set teleporters that the ancient civilization built with ancient magic. These were stationary transporters, to put it simply, like a Stargate. There's only one known individual who has ever achieved the ability to teleport by its own free will. But we have no idea how that knowledge was acquired or even how it really works. A very obscure form of ancient magic is also foretelling. Only rarely do people have the talent to use this, and there is basically nothing known about this sort of magic. The most prominent use of this magic that we know of is Abujin ibn Jadir ibn Umar Khalid ben Haji al-Charidi, where we can see that the visions of the future are scrambled and unclear, but simultaneously they are horrifyingly accurate once the context appears. Evidently, the orcs also make use of foretelling, predicting the emergence of a holy enemy, one who would bring an end to the War of Gods. For some reason, this magic is shunned by both the Circle of Fire and the Circle of Water, despite its incredible potential, and I found no reason as to why that is. Mentioning shunning magic practices, one form of magic that the Circle of Fire needs to use but doesn't really like is the art of summoning. Summoning means bringing animals or creatures of various kinds from other spheres into Morgrad. Since animals, demons, and other magical creatures all come from Beliar's realm, you can imagine that the followers of Enos didn't like this. Nonetheless, thanks to runes, they could minimize the dangers to themselves, as long as they wouldn't gaze too deeply into Beliar's realm, although that often didn't help them either. But when looking at it objectively, the Circle of Fire doesn't have a choice. Summoning magic is the basis for creating barriers, teleportation markers, and much more. Even breaking barriers is just another form of summoning magic. So for the Circle of Fire, it is still a required and very respected form of magic, but certainly also one that always draws ominous suspicions from all those around you. Necromancy is a form of summoning magic, but much more complicated. First off, necromancy through rune magic is summoning from other realms, and the monsters disappear after a short time. Plain and simple. Necromancy can also rarely happen naturally at locations with high concentrations of magic. Most often though, necromancy is used with intent. In both cases, the undead remain at that place until they are killed for good. That is also the primary reason why you would find undead in the wild. Those are just dead people without a soul that were raised through magic power to guard one thing or another. Perhaps they were just an accident, but those are the reasons why you would find undeath in the wild. To make this very clear, these undead are not summoned. They once were actual corpses. Interestingly, if said corpse was a magic user, then the arisen undead of that body will retain their ability to use magic. Lastly, legends speak of a different form of necromancy, one that involves summoning the spirit of the deceased for conversation or other harmonic reasons, but that goes a bit too far into spoiler territory. The final form of magic, which is also the largest in the universe of Gothic, is, as you could probably already guess, ancient magic. Although calling it final is highly ironic, as it was technically the first form of magic down the line. Anyway, once, this form of magic was the common kind, but as rune magic took over its job, the knowledge around it has been forgotten. Originally, only those who received the power of creation from the gods directly could use magic, but it wasn't a permanent privilege. Those who complained had their power reduced or outright removed. Those that were grateful had their powers increased. As an alternative, we know that drinking the tears of Enos had, for some people, the same effect without the need for blessings. Nonetheless, ancient magic can be described as the true, original magic, as it is the only form that doesn't require additional tools. The requirements for this magic are knowledge of the specific spell, acquired from either the gods directly or from mages who already master it, and one needs sufficient magic power to use it. Unlike rune magic, ancient magic has no limit in scale, which means that while it takes years to learn a single spell for the average person, said single spell is only limited by the skill, imagination, and power of its user. Meanwhile, in rune magic, the powers and limits of a spell are literally set in stone, as the sorcerer merely acts as a conduit in this case. For ancient magic, the sorcerer has free control over the spell's shape, strength, and duration, if said sorcerer is powerful enough. Although I need to once again mention the fact that the ability to use any ancient magic was extremely rare, even with training. Furthermore, ancient magic requires additional classification because we also have god-specific schools of magic as well as high ancient magic. To make it short, these spells scruff the walls between mortality and divinity. Let's begin with the god-specifics first. The school of fire that was born from Enos, which is also known as the magic of dominance, entails the elements of fire, light, and divinity. In other words, spells with fire or spells that deal in pure light or holy magic. Ironically, the art of healing, whether it's wounds, poison, stamina, whatever, were once born from the school of water. Adenos originally created this magic to balance out death and disease, which were creations of Beliar, but he didn't want to do anything that would put himself in direct opposition to his brother. At some point, when those spells looked really sparkly from a distance, Enos decided to steal the magic and claim it for himself. Can I just remind you of the fact that one of Enos' virtues is justice? This leads us to the School of Water, born from Adenos, also known as Transformation Magic, where obviously spells containing elements of water and ice are taught, but it goes way beyond that. As the name suggests, it also entails the magic of transformation into different animals or monsters, for example, as well as the ability to use telekinesis, time manipulation, taming monsters, sleeping spells, and even more than that. What is perhaps most fascinating about the transformation magic is that golems, goblins, and various animals seem to be summoned from Adenos' realm, not Beliar's. This is fascinating because it was originally Beliar who held claim over the animals. Speaking of whom, the School of Darkness, born from Beliar, is also known as the School of Summoning. Maybe you start to see why the Circle of Fire hates using summoning magic now, eh? Anyway, summoning magic deals primarily in death, poison, disease, lightning magic, memory manipulation, soul transference magic, weather manipulation, emotional manipulation, absorbing energy, instant death magics, demon and monster summoning magics. Long story short, I think you get the idea of what this magic is all about. Finally, and this is the last aspect of ancient magic that we need to discuss, there's high ancient magic. Magic exclusive to chosen ones, avatars, or those who achieved a state of true power. High fire magic entails summoning a burning blade, summoning a rain of fire, controlling humans, blessing a weapon with divine power, and summoning meteors. High black magic contains summoning lightning strikes, changing the day to night or night to day, and summoning an army of darkness. High water magic does not exist. Arcanos never had chosen ones or avatars, and besides that, he doesn't discriminate, and if he's going to commit genocide, he's going to commit genocide on a wide scale. Thus, with all this information finally out of the way, you should now have a thorough understanding of how magic works in the world of Gothic. However, not just the humans or the demons utilize magic. There's a vast culture of creatures also capable of using it, but that is a story for another day.